The United States banned the importation of slaves in 1808, but we didn't ban slavery in the United States until December of 1865 with the ratification of the 13th Amendment. And one of the things that means is that the vast majority of the slaves that were freed had been in the United States for many generations, and their history was largely lost to time. The dynamics of slavery means that the families had been broken up, and even oral histories were largely lost. And that leaves a specific gap in the historical record, because there are very few first-hand accounts of what life was like before the Middle Passage. But there is at least one extraordinary exception. Oluale Kossola, who is otherwise known as Cudjoe Lewis, was born in what is today Benin in West Africa around 1840, and like millions of others, his tribe was captured by a marauding tribe and sold to white slavers. And his extraordinary tale of capture and survival as one of the last slaves to be imported from Africa to the United States is history that deserves to be remembered. The United States was tearing itself apart. It was 1858, and the question of state sovereignty versus the federal government was about to come to a head in the American Civil War. Part of the issue of state sovereignty was also, of course, the question of slavery. Southern states wanted to keep slavery, seeing it as necessary for their economy. Most northern states wanted to abolish it. When the Founding Fathers drafted the Constitution, slavery in the fledgling country was already a question without an answer. In its final document, the Constitutional Congress wrote in Article 1, Section 9, that the government could not abolish the international slave trade until 1808. This compromise wouldn't stop the sale of slaves already in the U.S., but it would prevent new slaves from being transported into the country. Thomas Jefferson, who wanted the slave trade abolished, wrote, "What a stupendous, what an incomprehensible machine is man, who can endure toil, famine, stripes, imprisonment, and death itself in vindication of his own liberty, and in the next moment be deaf to all those motives whose power supported him through trial, and inflict on his fellow man a bondage, 1 hour of which is fraught with more misery than the ages of that which it rose in rebellion to oppose." When the slaver ship named Clotilda made its voyage to transport human cargo from the infamous port of Whydah to the United States in 1858, the importation of slaves had already been outlawed for 50 years. Yet they and hundreds of others did it anyway. Some historians estimate that in 1858 alone, more than 13,000 people were illegally smuggled into the United States by hundreds of ships from both the northern and southern states. Kossola was one of approximately 116 people who were transported on the Clotilda. Kossola would later tell journalists and authors, notably Zora Neale Hurston, who would go on to write such classics as Their Eyes Were Watching God, that he was 18 years old when his village was attacked by the king of the Dahomey. Prior to that fateful day, Kossola had lived a normal childhood. His grandfather was a wealthy man who served the local chieftain. Kossola told biographers that his own family didn't have the ivory by their door, which meant that they were not leaders of the tribe. Kossola was the son of the second wife of his father. His tribe practiced polygamy, with the husband's tent being situated in the middle of tents of his wives. Kossola described the marital process as being driven by the women, who would decide when and who to add to the family group. He said multiple marriages were the prerogative of the wealthy, because otherwise a man wouldn't be able to afford to feed his growing family. But he noted that there was a balance to be struck, because too many wives were a problem too. English wasn't his first language, but the author Hurston faithfully recorded Kossola's natural syntax in her book, Barracon, The Last Black Cargo, when he said, "Some got too many wives. When you hungry, it is painful. But when the belly too full, it painful too." Kossola said his village's system of justice was different than what existed in the United States. Of the latter, he would have quite a few experiences with before his death. He said when someone committed a serious crime in Africa, the village would summon the king and his officials, who would come and sit in judgment of the accused man with the village's elders. In one case that he remembered, Kossola said a man was accused and convicted of murder. As a death sentence, the king commanded the murderer be ritualistically cut on the chest and then tied with tight cords to the body of his victim, and then be left there until he too was dead. The symbolism of the cut was that the man was now dead in the eyes of the other villagers, who would ignore the killer's cries for mercy. Kossola said those people condemned to this punishment didn't last more than a few days, because people can stand the smell of the horse, the cow, and other beasts, but no man can stand the smell in his nostrils of a rotten man. In his remembrances of life in Africa to Hurston, Kossola also recalled the death of his grandfather and the ritualistic mourning of his wives. He said the dead were buried under the ground inside the house in which they had lived in life. The widows were required to mourn for their deceased husband for 2 years. He said for the first year, the widows wouldn't wash their faces, except with their tears. In addition to married life, the system of justice and mourning, Kossola said in his village there were multiple initiation rites for the young men of the tribe to undergo before they would be considered adults and worthy of taking part in the village council. Unfortunately, he was only able to do one of the initiations before his village was attacked by the Dahomey. According to Kossola, the king of the Dahomey sent a messenger to his village leader, demanding tribute from the crops in the fields. The leader, whom Kossola called Ikayon, refused to send tribute and said if the Dahomey spent more time growing their own crops, then they wouldn't need to demand tribute of the tribes around them. Using this refusal as a pretext, the king of the Dahomey sent his female warriors into Kossola's village at dawn and had his men surround all the exits. The slaughter of the elders in his village haunted Kossola for the rest of his life. He said the warriors chopped the heads off the people they killed and wore them on their belts. The young men and women were rounded up and taken to the seaport of Whydah, where he and others were sold, to Captain William Forster of the Clotilda. The Clotilda, owned by Timothy Meir, had sailed out of Alabama to Whydah with the expressed intent of purchasing slaves. According to some historians, Meir had made a large bet with another man that he could import slaves without being charged for the crime. Meir and his associates were later arrested for transporting Kossola and the other slaves to America, but when the Clotilda arrived, the Africans were hidden in the Alabama swamps, and the Clotilda was scuttled. Because no evidence of wrongdoing could be found, the court dismissed the case against Meir in 1861. The Clotilda's 1860 trip was among the last, by some accounts, maybe the very last, to bring African slaves into the United States. After surviving the harrowing Middle Passage, with its cramped quarters and restricted food and water, Kossola said he spent over 5 years as a slave for James Meir, the brother of Timothy Meir. He and a few others from the Clotilda worked hard chopping wood, providing fuel for a riverboat. Kossola said the Americans couldn't pronounce his real name, so he suggested they call him Cudjoe, which is a generic name for a male child who was born on a Monday. Some historians believe his last name, Lewis, was a corruption of his father's African name, Oluale. Kossola experienced culture shock in the United States, not just in his new reduced status as a slave, but also from the Americanized slaves, some of whom had lived in America for generations, and who seemed to him as foreign as his masters. He said he and the other Africans were mocked for wanting to dance cultural dances and for the way they talked in broken English. He described his new life as extremely hard, as he was physically exhausted all the time. When he and Meir's other slaves were freed after the U.S. Civil War had run its course, they wanted to return to Africa. They asked Meir for the money to return home, but were refused. A petition to the U.S. government was refused as well, so together the group worked and saved its money to purchase a plot of land in southern Alabama that they called Africa Town. It was only a handful of miles from Mobile, Alabama, but seemed further because it was isolated in the rural swamps. They created a society for Africans in America, built a church, and a school. Kossola entered a common law marriage with another Clotilda survivor named Abila, whom the Americans called Celia. He said when they both converted to Christianity, the other believers told him that he and Abila should be married in a church to have their marriage sanctioned in the eyes of God. They did so, but Kossola noted, "I don't love my wife no more with a license than I love her before the license. She a good woman, and I love her all the time." They had 5 sons and 1 daughter during their time together. Kossola gave his children both American and African names so they could understand where they came from but also fit in their new country with easily pronounceable names. Kossola told Hurston during one of their many interviews in the 1920s that his sons were fighters and wouldn't accept insults from anyone. He said his neighbors came to his home and told him that they thought his sons would kill someone because they were so argumentative. And he replied, "You see the rattlesnake in the woods? If you bother him, he bites you. If you know the snake shall kill you, why you bother him? Same way with my boys. You understand me?" Though he worried about his sons, they were not the first child Kossola would bury. Kossola and Abila lost their daughter to an illness when she was only 15 years old. He said it broke their hearts. Another of his sons, Cudjoe Fishington, was shot by a sheriff's deputy in the neck and said he shot in self-defense. Kossola brought his son home where he died. He said he mourned not just for the loss of his son and daughter, but also because his children never had the chance to see Africa, the place Kossola would always consider his home. Kossola was struck by a train in Mobile in March 1902. He said he was passing another cart in the street when he reached the train tracks and didn't see the train coming when it hit him. A lawyer was able to get a judgment for damages from the railroad for $650, but Kossola said he never saw a penny of the money. As he related to Hurston, he held no grudges about the money and considered it a miracle to have survived the accident. The people of Africatown supported Kossola by making him the sexton of the church, so he was still able to earn a wage, even with his injuries. More tragedy struck when one of Kazula's sons was struck and killed by a train, and another died of illness. He and Abile lost their children to accidents or disease, one after another. When Abile died in 1908, Kossola said he guessed she had left him to go be with their children. He would outlive his entire family, except for a daughter-in-law and some grandchildren. Despite his decades away from his homeland, Kossola and the other survivors of the Clotilda expressed a hope that if they would tell their story to authors and journalists, that it would eventually be heard by their family or someone who remembered them in Africa. He talked at length about his deep sadness after the death of his family. He told a story to illustrate his plight. He said, "God gave man six appendages to defend himself during his time on earth. 2 feet, 2 hands, 2 eyes. If he loses his feet, he can still defend himself with his eyes and his hands. If his hands are cut off, he can still avoid the blows that are thrown at him. But if he loses his feet, his hands, and his eyes, he has no more defenses. My sons were my feet to me, my daughter my hands, my wife my eyes. I have no more defenses." Oluale Kossola was the last known survivor of the Atlantic slave trade between Africa and the United States. He passed away in July of 1935 at the age of 94 or 95. He is buried in Plateau Cemetery in Africatown, Alabama. I hope you enjoyed this episode of The History Guy, short snippets of forgotten history between 10 and 15 minutes long. And if you did enjoy, please go ahead and click that thumbs up button. If you have any questions or comments or suggestions for future episodes, please write those in the comment section. I will be happy to personally respond. Be sure to follow The History Guy on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and check out our merchandise on teespring.com. And if you'd like more episodes on forgotten history, all you need to do is subscribe.